Still rocking after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equal. From San Francisco, USA, online since 2004, it's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show. With the original rock and roll geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name's Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Thursday, September 20th, 2018. It's 9:49 a.m. Why is it so early? And why am I doing a show this early? I never do a show this early, but I just got off the phone with Zal Clemenson. You may not know who Zal Clemenson is, but he is somebody I like a lot. If you're a Nazareth fan, actually two of my favorite Nazareth albums are No Mean City and Malice in Wonderland. Came out in like 79 and 80, I believe. Don't quote me on that. I could be wrong on the date, on the years, but I think that's about right. I think No Mean City came out in 79. Anyway, when Nazareth put out Expect No Mercy, and that was probably their... Anyway, after Expect No Mercy, they got another guitar player because Manny was their only guitar player, and they got this guy named Zal Clemenson in the band. When I was a kid, 79, I was probably, I don't know, 17, 18 years old back then. Math ain't me forte. When I was a kid, I didn't know who Zal Clemenson was, but I found out that he was from this band called the Sensational Alex Harvey Band. Zal Clemenson... he made these two albums way better than any other Nazareth album to me. No Mean City. Go back and listen to No Mean City. It's one of the great albums of all time. It's probably the most heavy at the time of any of the Nazareth albums, and it's just really good. Manny's a fantastic guitar player in his own right, but then they brought in this other guy, Zal, and the two of them complimented each other so well. Anyway, I talked to Zal Clemenson on the phone today. I've had everybody... from Nazareth now, with the exception of the new guys, of the current guys that they have, all the old lineup, I've talked to just about everybody in Nazareth except for Billy Rankin. So Zal Clemenson, it was nice to talk to him today. He was in Glasgow, Scotland. They were rehearsing for some gigs. He's still playing. And the guy is an incredible guitar player. And I was a little bit nervous, but he put me at ease. He was a nice guy. I don't know why I get nervous interviewing these people, but I do, because they're my rock heroes, and I always get that feeling that I'm not worthy to be talking to these guys, but he was a really nice guy. I talked to him for about 35 minutes, talked about, you'll hear what he talked about. It's a decent interview. I could have been better, but what can I tell you, friends? All right, before I get into the before I get into the Zal Clemenson interview, it's a train wreck, folks. The interview's not. The show is. Before I get into the Zal Clemenson interview, I'm going to play a song for you from... I might as well play something from the Sensational Alex Harvey Band, and then we'll go right into the interview. This is the last of the Teenage Idols. Before I do that, let me tell you how you can reach me. Oh, by the way, I'm getting on a plane tonight at... 12:55 a.m. I'm going to Florida to hunt deer. I drew a deer tag. I went to the archery range yesterday. I hadn't pulled the bow out in, it's probably been at least a year since last time I went hunting in Florida. And I've had this problem with my shoulder, and I went to shoot the bow yesterday at the archery range, and I couldn't pull the fucking bow back. I lost all the strength in my shoulder. So I'm flying to Florida tonight. Hopefully my shoulder will be back to strength, because if I see a deer, I can't pull the bow back. Good for the deer, not so much for me, friends. All right. Anyway, I'm doing that. I'll be back on Wednesday. So I'm going to try to get this posted before I leave. So there'll be an episode. Thank you, Zal Clemenson, for coming on the show. If you like the interview, go to Zal's page on Facebook, Zal Clemenson, which, by the way, I'll post links to everything Zal Clemenson on show notes at rockandrollgeek.com. Thank you for listening, friends. I hope you enjoy this interview. Here is the Sensational Alex Harvey Band And I'll come back and say some parting words after the interview.
Steal my mind.
Hello, Zal. This is Michael Butler.
Hi, Michael, man. Good timing. Good timing. We were just in the middle of rehearsal, but that's a good call. How you doing?
I'm super great. Thanks for answering the phone. I appreciate it. So who are you rehearsing with? What is the rehearsal?
We're rehearsing for a couple of shows. We're doing it tomorrow night and Saturday night down in England. So we're just rehearsing up in Glasgow at the minute with the full band. Yeah, yeah.
Is this Sendogs?
This is Sendogs, yeah, yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
you're in Scotland right now?
We're in Glasgow right now, yeah, yeah, right. We are indeed.
How's the weather in Scotland?
The weather is pretty windy. Wet and windy. Just so it's like summertime, you know.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you taking time. I appreciate you taking time.
That's cool.
I appreciate you taking time out of rehearsal to speak to me on this.
No, we're just having a break. No, that's cool. You picked the right time.
I am a huge fan. Those two Nazareth albums that you're on are probably two of my favorite albums of all time. But
yeah, nice album. Yeah, yeah. The Malice in Wonderland is an interesting album. It's a change of direction, I think, in a way. But yeah, it's a nice album.
I'll get to those albums in a second, if you don't mind. But I found out about Alex Harvey Band when I was about 18 years old, back in like 1982. I was in this punk rock.
Yeah.
I was in this punk rock band, and the singer always said, "Oh, you got to listen to this band called the Sensational Alex Harvey Band," and he used to sing Action Stress all the time. And looking back, I was looking at a bunch of Alex Harvey videos, and I realized that my singer completely stole Alex Harvey's whole stage thing, and it kind of made me
persona.
made me realize how influential you guys were. Do you know how many bands that you guys influenced?
Yeah, not initially. No. Initially, we never really thought of it like that. It's only as the years have gone by, and more people have contacted me when I've got back into the business right now with the Sendogs. And obviously, a lot of people come out of the woodwork. A lot of fans say, "Oh, you're back playing again," and then you get all those kind of sad fans saying, or all the bands that you kind of saying, "Wow, you know." So it's kind of snowballed in a way from that, and it's pleasing to know. It's nice to hear people say that we had an influence in that way. But at the time, we just did what we did. We weren't really conscious of it, to be perfectly honest. Yeah.
The band was. What made you guys so great? That same thing that makes every band so great is the total originality. There was nobody like what you guys were doing. Bon Scott, totally influenced by you guys.
The AC/DC boys are big fans.
I would say Brian Johnson probably was. There was a band in Australia called the Skyhooks. Completely. Do you know that band?
No, I don't know them, but I saw an Australian band recently, and you probably know them, Rose Tattoo.
Oh, yeah, Rose Tattoo, influenced by Alex
Harvey. Rose Tattoo, they were in Glasgow just recently. I went down to see them and met the guys and had a chat, and they were big fans. Yeah, were like, "Wow, sounds you've come down to the show." So it was nice to speak to them.
The band Skyhooks is from Australia, and their guy in the band pretty much wore the mime makeup. They pretty much did you guys' entire thing. I can name so many more. There is The Damned were influenced by you guys. Sex Pistols were influenced by Nazareth. Influenced.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
That must make you.
It was a band that, as you say, it had a very original stamp and an original sort of approach. And Alex himself had that in mind, I think, when he put the band together or when we got together. He wanted it to be a kind of something special, something a little bit different. And at times, I thought we were. You mentioned the band being popular in that sense, but for me, there was an area where we kind of indulged a little too much, perhaps, too diverse and became a little too indulgent. And I think, in a way, we missed out on the mainstream rock audience that I would call a mainstream rock audience. And it became more like a cult band, I think, Saab, than anything else. But hey, that's what the band is all about, and that's what Alex wanted to do with the band. Yeah.
Well, the cult bands may not be great for your financial future, but those kind of bands, those kind of bands go down in history a lot better than bands who.
I dig it. Yeah, I appreciate that. I dig that.
How did you originally meet Alex Harvey? You had a band called Tear Gas with the rest of the guys in the band.
Tear Gas were like a heavy metal rock band in Scotland. And we had a couple of albums we got out recorded, and we did some touring, got to Europe and so on. So we did okay, but we really did miss a singer. We really didn't have a proper Robert Plant or Ian Gillan. We were always looking for somebody to just finish it off in that way, you know. So the music was all there, the band was all there, the musicians were there, but we just always liked this singer. And I think it was, I think there was a collaboration between our management, Teargas, and Alex had a manager at the time. And they kind of collaborated, I think, to sort of put us together. It's all very secretive. And so we met and we played some shows with Alex. He had his own band called Giant Moth, played the Marquee Club in London. And Teargas was supporting him. And I think that was a way of us kind of, you know, sort of eyeing each other up and sort of testing each other out a little bit to see what we were all about. And then we finally got a rehearsal. Alex came up to Glasgow. We were still in Glasgow, and he came up, brought his guitar up, and we booked a rehearsal studio. And he came in and just plugged in his guitar, and he says to the guy, he said to us, he says, can you play this riff? And he played the riff out of Midnight, from Midnight Moses, from the Framed Up. And he says, can you play this riff? And we went, yeah, yeah, we'll play that. So we just beat the shit out of it, you know, as you guys did. And Alex, I could see Alex's big grin on his face. He just looked around the room and just went, yeah, that'll do. And that was the moment for me when it just kind of, you know, it gelled. I knew right away it was going to work.
Had you guys known of him before you did that gig together?
Yeah, yeah. We knew Alex. We had a big soul band. It was like a kind of a, like a James Brown kind of thing with brass and all that soul funk stuff. They had a really fantastic band called the Big Soul Band. And, so we knew of him. We knew his reputation. We knew how good he was in terms of his musicality and his musical ability. But he just wanted to move into something much more progressive. And of course, that's what Teargas were all about, you know, playing progressive rock. And so it was kind of a marriage made in hell, made in heaven, I suppose.
He was kind of like, the stuff he did on stage was kind of like out there, and nobody had done that. Was he like that in his band before you guys?
No, he wasn't. No, when I say the band that we played supported him was a band called, I say, Giant Moth, and it was a three-piece band. And Teargas had played before them on the Marquee, and then Alex came on with this three-piece band, and I thought they were absolutely dreadful. They were trying to be progressive, but they were awful. They were just awful musically. But I could see Alex. I could see something in him. I could see that spark, that visual thing that he has, that sort of magnetism. And I knew right away that there was something about him, you know, that he was serious about it, and he was determined to kind of make it all work. So I think when he got together with us, I think it was a marriage made in heaven for him, that you had a really powerful rock band who could all play and were pretty versatile in terms of how we could treat the style of music that Alex wanted to do. Was all pretty diverse, you know, songs like Next. You know, there was a whole series of songs that were really quite awkward in a way for Teargas to cover because of the style of the song. But it was about providing a backdrop, I think, is what we did for Alex. It's more of an orchestration for him to really put a song across and really feel comfortable. That's how he wanted to perform. He wanted to do the whole theatrical presentation and kind of get people's imaginations going. And so that's really how it all worked.
Were you guys doing the theatrical thing in Teargas before Alex came?
No, not at all. No, we were kind of heavy metal, heads down, you know.
Did you just stood
with
there?
The hair covered in hair. Sort of standing there, just trying to be Led Zeppelin and trying to be Deep Purple. But no, there wasn't an awful lot of theatrics at all. Alex always used to say that we were kind of extrovert off stage and a little bit introvert when we went on stage. So he kind of swapped that round in a way. He sort of treated the whole band like he was the director of a show.
Yeah.
And he was looking at everyone and looking at everyone's personality and saying, right, how can we develop this? What can we do here? You know, what's the strong points? What's the things that we can work on? And he did direct things very much in that way.
Did you go through any, like, name ideas before you settled on the Sensational Alex Harvey Band?
No, I think Alex just came up with that.
And you
it just came right up. Yeah, that was it. We just went with it, yeah. It sounded like, you know, I think what it comes from is Alex was used to always say to us, you know, when you see a poster back then, the Tamla Motown days, when it was like the Fabulous Four Tops,
right,
you know,
exactly.
the terrific, you know, Temptations and the such and such. There was always a sort of adjective in front of everybody. So he thought, yeah, the Sensational Alex Harvey Band, that's what we would be, you know. He was very proud of the idea that we were always described as being sensational.
It was kind of you guys' band that he came into you guys' band. So were you guys okay with the band name being named after the singer?
Yeah. It wasn't tried and tested at that time. You know, for us, it was just like a way of keeping Tear Gas together. But one of the main things we thought was, well, at that point, Tear Gas were on the verge of breaking up. Certainly because we couldn't find anybody to sing. And so we were struggling a little bit at that point. So Ted, the drummer, said to me, look, at least it keeps the band together. You know, we weren't sure where it was going to go. We weren't sure if Alex was the right man or not, really, in that sense. But what the outcome was going to be long term. So it was just a question saying, right, at least it keeps Tear Gas together, and then let's see what happens. And, of course, the rest is history, in it, as they say, anyway.
Do you remember the first gig you guys ever did?
We did a few kind of places, warm-up shows that were really quite kind of secretive and off like islands off the west coast of Scotland. You know, really, you know, you had to get on a ferry to go to this place, you know, and it was like a little village hall, and we played there, and we'd be like, I don't know, half a dozen, 10 people would be there, sheep farmers and stuff like that. And so we did all these kind of strange little places just to sort of warm the band up and just see how it all felt. And we did a few of those, maybe two or three of those sort of gigs, before we started to do the real serious stuff and get on the road and do the bigger clubs and the bigger venues. So, it was quite a modest start, to be honest.
How long before you started wearing the makeup?
I'm not sure exactly how long it took. I don't think it was that long. What the makeup was all about was... I used to be I was in the habit of parodying, as we say, sort of guitar. I always used to find the Guitar Hero quite an amusing sort of figure, an amusing persona. And I used to always look at guitar players with all that angst and all the kind of emotion and all the kind of,
right,
you know, when they're ringing out a solo, there's all that facial stuff and there's all that kind of posing and so on. And I used to find that quite amusing. So I would just kind of ape that. I would kind of parody that on stage and do all the kind of, you know, like I'm being a Guitar Hero, basically. But what happened was, as the gigs got bigger and bigger, our manager came up and says, look, the people at the back further down the hall cannot see what you're doing. They cannot see all that stuff that you're doing there. How can we project? How can we make that project further into the gig? And we came up, we went to see Marcel Marceau, the man himself. We went to see all that mime stuff. And we convinced, we came up with a face that just projected. You know, people could see from anywhere in the hall. People could see what we were actually doing. And the little things that Alex and I used to get up to, the little tricks and things, the little bits of theatre that we used to do. So it was a way of just projecting that persona into a wider audience.
The videos that I watched of Alex Harvey, what was so cool about it is when he had the sinister look on his face, you know, when he's singing the song, and then you can see you in the background, even more sinister. It was fucking badass.
Alex always looked kind of, as you say, quite sinister and quite heavy and quite menacing, you know. And of course, he liked the idea of that, of putting something across. Yeah. And of course, being from Scotland, being Glaswegian, being from Glasgow, everybody thinks, oh, these are a bunch of hard cases, you know, a bunch of hooligans. But really, in actual fact, we were perfectly nice pacifists, you know, hippies, basically, is what we were. But he liked that persona, Alex. He liked that aggression. He liked that. I think the thing you mentioned earlier about punk bands, I think they picked up a lot on that, on Alex's his persona and the kind of almost like an aggressive approach, a really sort of in-your-face approach.
Yeah, and not caring.
Presenting them.
Just not giving a shit what people thought.
Yeah, absolutely. You love us or hate us. That was exactly it. Alex wanted to get a reaction one way or another. That's what he was all about. He says, right, we're going to get a reaction. If they hate us, they throw stones at us, brilliant. That's fantastic as well. You know, he was like, you know. So there was people who we did a tour with Slade, for example, in the UK.
Yeah.
And the Slade, we supported Slade, and the Slade fans fucking hated us. They didn't like us at all. You know, it was all too kind of in your face, you know. But, and then the funny thing was, 6 months, a year later, we went out on tour and headlined ourselves, and the place was full of Slade fans.
Yeah, I wonder what, maybe they didn't like it because they thought you guys, because when you were wearing the costumes and makeup, maybe they thought you were making fun of their heroes. I don't know.
I think there might have been a touch of that, yeah. I think you're probably right that we were taking the piss. But yeah, so there was a lot of tongue-in-cheek, a lot of irony in Sam, you know, there definitely was.
Yeah, a lot of taking the piss out of it. And...
Yeah.
So, oh, by the way, I just got this book. Somebody sent me the book about Sensation. It's by John Neil Monroe. Have you read that book?
Yes. I think that's one of the first books to come out, actually, I think. One of the early ones, yeah.
I have not. I'm getting on a plane tonight. I'm bringing it with me. I can't wait to read it. So while the Alex Harvey, while the band's going, did you guys already know the guys in Nazareth? I know you had the same management.
Yeah. We had the same management. We knew the guys. We knew they'd started in a different part of Scotland from us, but we knew of each other, and then eventually we were with the same management team. And so we used to share offices and stuff like that. We used to share flats down in London when we stayed in London with the neighbor. They were on tour, we would stay at the flat. When we were on tour, they would stay at the flat. You know, it was a kind of a sharing. We knew each other very well.
Did they ever tell you how much that you guys influenced them? Because you obviously did.
Not really, no. They had kind of already established themselves, actually, before Saab kind of kicked off. Nazareth were pretty big at that point. From what I remember, they were quite a big band themselves. So
okay.
I wasn't really aware that they had... we had influenced them in any way, but I think long term, I think there was a certain degree of the idea of maybe being a little more theatrical and maybe being a little more more upfront about how you do things. So yeah, but because we got together, we did Dan's solo. Dan had a little solo album that was all Saab that played on it.
Yeah,
so,
that's right. I was going to ask you.
We were really. Yeah.
While the band was going, while Sensation Alex Harvey band was going, Dan makes a solo album. Did the management put that together, or did he say, "Hey, I want you guys to be the backing band on the solo album"?
No, it was not Manny. Manny was, I think they wanted us to come and play.
Manny
was producing. Right. He produced it, yeah, and he was desperate for us to come and play on it. He wanted the whole Assad to do the album with Dan, and so that's how that came together. Yeah,
Alex was okay with that.
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Everybody got all friends. No real competition.
Yeah, not at all. No, it was all sweet. And it was a great album. It's a fantastic album.
Yeah, there's a lot of covers on the album, but I have that on vinyl. It's a good album. So when were you approached to be on? Because Nazareth was, they had just put out Expect No Mercy, which was probably their biggest album before that. You know, that was their kind of their breakthrough album.
Yeah.
And after that, they get you in the band. How did that, why do you think they wanted to do that?
I think perhaps, a couple of reasons. At the time, the Harvey band had split up, obviously, and I was driving a taxi cab around London just make a living. And then I got a call. Manny got in touch with me, and he said, "We started recording an album. This was the No Mean City album. Mm-hmm. And they had a mobile studio on an island off the English coast. And so they'd set up there with this mobile recording studio. And he says, "Come over." See what we're doing. And I went, so I just said, "Yeah, great, I'll come over." And they were sort of halfway through the album, and I think what they were looking for was a little bit more of input, a little bit more songwriting, some fresh ideas. I think they were just looking for some fresh ideas and some songs. And I had a few things lying around that I'd been playing about with, and I said, "Hey, you know, try this, try that." So it was quite loose to begin with, and then it kind of fell into place there. And by that time, on the back of that, they were out in the States again touring. Out touring in America and so on, and they said, and again, Manny says to me, "Come, do you want to come over and see what we're doing over here?" And I went, "Yeah, okay, I'll come over." And I was really quite surprised. I was pleasantly surprised to see just how big the band were in America and the kind of size of venues, stadium gigs that they were playing. I thought, "Wow." I thought, "Yeah." And he says, "Look, do you want to be a part of this? Do you want to get involved?" And I went, "Yeah, why not? Let's do it." So.
When they brought you over to the U.S. to tour with them, were they still supporting Expect No Mercy?
Yeah, we did all the songs. Yeah, we did all the full repertoire.
You actually played
all the back catalog.
You actually played with them on the Expect No Mercy tour?
I can't remember the exact tour. Because Manny was really keen to have a second guitar player. I think he really wanted that to help put just create a bigger sound, you know, and sort of cover some of the guitar parts that he couldn't play because of the way the band was set up.
when you came back in the when you came into Nazareth, to me, can you hear me okay? Because I hear music behind you. You can hear me okay?
Yeah, the band have just kicked off a bit. Yeah, but no, you're okay. I'm in the studio. I'm in the recording room.
Okay,
you're fine. You're okay. I can hear you.
When you came into Nazareth, it brought them to a completely other level. I mean, they became like way better than they were.
Yeah, I never. Again, it was one of those moments when I was never really aware of the input. I was just there to kind of contribute as another member of the band and another guitar player. And it all came quite natural to me. I never really thought that there was anything, you say, anything seminal or anything sort of turning point or anything like that. It just felt like it sounded like a natural progression. And I thought the album, Malice in Wonderland, was quite a departure from the heavier stuff. It was the Jeff Baxter production,
yeah,
was slightly lighter, slightly more AOR, perhaps, and I wasn't sure whether they'd taken a right turn there or they'd sort of, you know, lost their heaviness and gone a little more. Manny used to always talk about Fleetwood Mac. He was a big fan of Fleetwood Mac, of the Rumours album at that time, and he was always playing the Rumours album. And I think he had his idea on, or he had his eye on having a much more commercial sounding record, let's put it that way, you know, a more wider audience, if you like.
I heard that Manny was kind of upset when they brought in Skunk Baxter to do Malice in Wonderland, because he had been producing.
I don't know.
He had been producing.
Yeah,
he did No Mean City, which was like a super heavy album. Then Malice in Wonderland.
Yeah.
I think it's a great album.
I was kind of surprised as well. I mean, I was quite surprised that that was the producer as well, but I don't know. I don't know what the politics were at the time, where the record company had, you know, had a hand in it and so on. But I found it surprising that a band like Nazareth would bring in someone like Jeff Baxter to produce. Yeah, so it was kind of strange, but it worked out okay. I mean, he was a nice guy and he was a great musician, obviously. So yeah, it was cool.
So everybody got along with Jeff Baxter okay during Mel?
Yeah,
really?
Yeah,
they did, okay.
Yeah. Huh. Lots of cocaine going down. Yeah, they all got
really
quite happy.
Were you doing the coke too?
No, not me, man. I just don't. I can't go near it. So
you're probably the only one.
Yeah, they all
wasn't.
They all enjoyed it. Oh no, one or two guys, not the whole band. One or two guys liked it.
How many songs on No Mean City were written before when you came in to record it already? Because I know you got.
I would say probably about three or four. Three or four sub-tracks maybe they had done.
You did Simple Solution.
Then,
that was totally yours, Simple Solution?
Yeah. I brought that in, yeah. It was a thing I'd working on. Because I'm a big fan of Frank Zappa.
Oh, yeah.
And I have been from day one. Yeah. You know, he's a big, big influence on me. And I used to play about with a lot of stuff. A lot of funny time signatures and stuff that had a slight jazz feel to it at times. And, you know, that kind of, that Zappa-esque kind of humor as well was always something that appealed to me. And so that's a lot where a lot of those ideas at that time I was playing about with stuff, and I think the guys liked the idea that it was something maybe a little bit more progressive in some ways. But that seemed to work out for them.
Did you change your guitar setup or anything like that to fit Nazareth?
Not really.
Better? No.
Not really. No, it was the same system, same setup. No,
what
no.
was the setup?
Played louder. You had to play louder. That was about it, yeah.
You had to play softer? Oh, louder, yeah. You had to play
louder. Louder, yeah, no, louder.
What was your
louder, yeah.
What was the setup back then?
The rig, guitar-wise?
Yeah.
I think it was just a Marshall rig. Just, you know, pretty much a Marshall.
And you
we played about with some different rigs to try.
Did you play the SG too? Because you played that in Alex Harvey band.
So
Manny played the Les Paul, and I would have thought if he brought in a second guitar player, that the second guitar player would maybe play a Fender or something like that. But you stayed with the Gibson.
I had the Gibson. Yeah, I played the Gibson. But we played around. He had a couple. I think we did play a Strat at one time on some of the recordings.
Yeah,
so maybe in a Strat. But on stage it was always the SG. Yeah.
I really wish there were some video footage of you you in Nazareth. The only one I could find was the Top of the Pops, where you guys are lip syncing.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, it's okay.
To Holiday or something, one of those songs, isn't it?
Oh, that's right. You're on Holiday, too. There's that video,
maybe,
too.
Maybe Sunshine, yeah.
You wrote Hearts Grown Cold on, is that completely your song?
Hearts Grown Cold, yeah. It's a song I wrote, yeah.
That
I had
is
that
a
song
great
all written before.
That was probably my favorite. Back then, when Alice in Wonderland came out, that was probably my favorite. What about Talking to One of the Boys? How much did you have to do with that?
Yeah. I got that, yeah. I brought that in as well, yeah.
The solo on that.
Showdown at the Border was a song I had already had.
You liked both those albums, okay?
Yeah. I'd say the second, the Malice one, I always thought was a slight departure, but it seemed to be that that's what they were thinking of doing, was maybe moving into a more of a MOR type situation. I thought that's a bit odd, you know, because of a pretty heavy rock band at that time.
A lot of people, I talked to the guy who wrote this book called Razzmatazz, who's a friend of mine, Robert Lawson, and he didn't have too many good things to say about Malice in Wonderland. But I used to work on a fishing boat when I was like 16 years old, and when I would have, we would have to watch the wheel when the boat's traveling in the middle of the night. Malice in Wonderland got me. I burnt that album out. It was just nonstop Malice in Wonderland. So big part of my life.
Yeah, that's cool. It's cool. It's nice when an album has that effect on you. You really tune into it, and it just sort of grabs you. I guess is what it does. Yeah.
How did those tours, the U.S. tours, go with Nazareth?
They were great. They were, as I say, they were big venues, big shows, some big stadiums, and Superdome, stuff like that, and Dallas Cowboys Stadium, and all those sort of things. Some big
venues. Yeah, you guys played a lot of like festival shows in stadiums during that time.
It was a big deal.
Saw Nazareth many times in my life, but I never saw them during those two album periods. They never came. I was in the South, and they never came during that time. I saw them on Expect No Mercy, and you were not with them when I saw them. But that was when Dan had to sit down because he had like a back injury or something like that. He sat down for the entire show.
Before I joined him. Yeah.
Why did you end up leaving the band? Because they were like, to me, they were just on fire at that point. And next thing you know, full circle.
I guess, as I mentioned earlier, I was working on stuff that was kind of a little more diverse and a little more in the Zappa sort of. I was really getting into more jazz and more kind of stuff that's a bit more way out, I guess is the best way of putting it. I think it was just too off the wall to say, well, here's an idea for Nazareth, because it just wouldn't have been a song for Nazareth at all. It was more instrumental. It was more improvised, let's say, in some respects. So it was. And I just got to the stage where I thought, well, I can't come up with any more musical ideas or any more songs that seem to fit the bill in terms of being in Nazareth. And I said to the guys, well, I'm going to go away and just work on some stuff on my own and see what happens. And eventually, I met up again with Barry Barlow, drummer from Jethro Tull, and that's when I put a band together with him, playing more experimental sort of stuff. Yeah.
What was that band called?
So that band was called Tandoori Cassette. It was very obscure. And I had Charlie Tumahai from Bebop Deluxe on bass. Uh-huh. And Ronnie Lee, he was the keyboard player, funnily enough. I know Ronnie joined Nazareth a few years later. But yeah, Ronnie was the keyboard player.
During the what they called the Nazareth Orchestra time.
Yeah. I've seen some clips of Dan singing in Germany, is it, with the orchestra and stuff.
Didn't you do what I'm saying is they had a full band. They had two keyboard players. They may have even had two drummers. And they called themselves
John Locke, was it?
Yeah,
keyboard,
that's right.
The name is about John Locke.
They called themselves the Nazareth Orchestra. That was
right. No, I didn't know that. That's cool.
Afterwards, didn't you do something with Dan afterwards, the Party Boys or something like that with Billy?
Yeah, Ted from the Harvey Band wanted to put a kind of pickup band together where we just got guests. Where, the guest singer would come along or the guest musician would join. So it was a kind of flexible kind of jam session type situation, and it was called the Party Boys. So anybody could join in. Fish from Marillion, he would turn up and sing a bit. Dan would come and sing. Pete would come along and do a bit. So, yeah,
I think I read that the guy who replaced you in Nazareth was also in that band, Billy Rankin.
Yeah, Billy was in called the Zal Band. After the Harvey Band split, there was a band I had called. The record company wanted us to stay together and put something together, so they called it the Zal Band. And Billy became a second guitar player.
Really?
And that lineup we had Leroy Jones, American singer who worked with the Tubes.
Uh-huh,
he was one of the backing dancers with the Tubes, the backup singer. And he joined us, but it was very short-lived and very ill-conceived kind of project. It just didn't take off at all.
You're the only guy, but you are the last guy I've talked to in Nazareth, other than Billy Rankin. I got to talk to Billy Rankin, but
Billy's a cool guy. He knows, he's got a lot of good stories, actually.
I think doesn't he live in the United States now?
No, he lives here in Scotland.
Oh,
he stays back
in
Scotland.
Yeah. Well, Zal, thank you for doing this. I really appreciate it.
No,
I'm a huge fan.
Great chatting to you, man. So you've got, this is a part of a radio station you've got going? Or
it's a podcast. I've been doing this for about 15 years, almost 15 years, but it's...
Fantastic. And you're in San Francisco, you know Frisco, yeah?
That's right, yeah. I used to be...
Whereabouts? I know Frisco quite well. I mean, up Pacific Heights and up the top, Chinatown, all that. I used to know quite well.
Pacific Heights is the rich neighborhood. I live out in the... I live out by the beach. Ocean Beach is where I live.
Yeah, sounds great. That's a lovely city. I love that. It's one of my favorite places, Frisco. Fabulous.
So who's in the band now?
Thin Dogs is a bunch of Scottish musicians, apart from a drummer who's Brazilian. But, the funny thing is that the majority of the guys played in a Saab tribute band
in
Scotland. They used to cover the whole Saab repertoire dress up and do the whole thing. And I'd seen them a couple of times and I thought, yeah, these guys are pretty good. They really did it well. And when I started putting Thin Dogs together, I thought, hey, maybe these are the guys that could do the job for me, and funnily enough, that's just what's happened. So, yeah, it's worked out really well.
Did the bass player, did he play with Michael Schenker?
No, that's from Saab, that's Chris.
Okay, yeah.
He's from Sensational Like Saab Band.
Okay,
yeah, he played with Schenker. And Ted, the drummer. They both played with Schenker, yeah.
Okay, yeah, because I saw Michael Schenker last year, and that guy was on bass. I wonder if Ted was on drums.
It would probably be, yeah. Huh. They're out touring all the time with him, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Alex, I wish Alex was still with us. Zal.
Yeah, me too, man. But yeah.
So, are you guys recording or just rehearsing?
We're just rehearsing for these upcoming shows. Yeah.
You guys, do you do any? I'm assuming you do a lot of Saab songs.
No, well, when I initially put the band Thin Dogs together, I was quite adamant that I was not going to do any Saab material.
It was all
going to be completely original, because it's all original songs that we started with, and I wanted to stick to that, basically. But there was so much pressure from fans and people
imagine.
And Phil, you got to do some Saab. So we do two songs. We do Isabel Gowdy and we do Faith Healer, which kind of tie in lyrically and thematically with how Thin Dogs play and what we're all about. So they work really well on the set. They go down great.
No thought of doing Simple Solution?
Not really, no. That would freak the guys out, I think, if we try to do that. But yeah. You never know. It's a long time since I've heard it. So I'd have to give it another ear hole and just check it out again. But yeah, maybe. You never know.
That's my... No Mean City is actually my favorite Nazareth album. That album, top to bottom, is just a brilliant album.
That's cool. It's a great album.
It's probably,
great sleeve as well. Great cover.
Yeah, probably the most heavy album that they did, I think.
Yeah.
Still in touch with those guys at all?
No, I don't see any of them, really. There's occasionally when there's a function. The last time I saw Pete and Dan was at a Frankie Miller concert in aid of Frankie Miller. It was in Glasgow.
Yeah,
that was a big show. Joe Walsh was on it and stuff like that. We did a few songs, with Dan. But that's the last time I saw them. That's a long time ago.
You know, Dan retired.
Yes, I know he's suffering from something. I don't know.
They were on tour
in his chest.
They were on tour in the United States, and a band I was in was supporting them, and they canceled that day because he had to go back home because he had a heart problem or something. It was really sad.
Wow.
I love that.
Yeah,
guy.
Yeah, I know.
That guy is one of the top two singers probably in the entire world.
Yeah, he's got a unique voice.
Yep.
Absolutely unique. Like, unbelievable voice.
Which is what makes a great singer
Nazareth.
Anybody.
Absolutely. It's like Axl Rose or something.
Exactly. Well, Axl was like him.
Mm.
Okay, Zal, I thank you so much. I'll let you get back to practice. Good luck with the gigs.
Okay, buddy. And thank you so much, and it's really nice to chat to you.
It was an honor to talk to you.
Hopefully meet up one day. It'd be great.
Yes. Come to San Francisco. I'll let you can crash on my house. I got a spare bedroom.
Definitely. Sounds like a good offer, mate. All sounds right. great to me.
All right. Thanks.
All right, Mike.
I appreciate
Take
it.
Take care, buddy.
I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Take care. Bye-bye. No, bye-bye.
There you go. Zal Clementson, the great Zal Clementson. All right. Why don't we close out with Simple Solution from No Mean City. I will talk to you soon, friends. Thank you for listening. Rockandrollgeek.com is where you can find this show. Rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. Send me an email. Go to Zal Clementson's Facebook page. Let him know you heard him on the Rock and Roll Geek show so he doesn't think he wasted 35 minutes of his time on this crappy podcast, friends. Thank you for the donations. Please keep the donations coming, because without your donations, this show would die a horrible, putrid, stench-filled death. I'll talk to you soon. Here is Simple Solution. Look.
It's a rock and roll geek train wreck.